Welcome everybody to the IMSC Algebraic Combinatorics Seminar. It's a great pleasure to have today Amruta P. from IISER Thiruvananthapuram. She's going to talk about the determinant of representations of generalized symmetric groups. Amruta, please.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon. So I'm going to talk on our recent work with my guide, Dr. Geeta Thangavelu, on the determinant of representations of generalized symmetric group. So let me first tell you about the group. The generalized symmetric group is the reproduct of a cyclic group of order R and a symmetric group of order N. By reproduct, we mean the semi-direct product of CR to the power N and SN. Okay. Now, let us quickly recall some basic definition. First of all, suppose V is a vector space of dimension D over a field F. A representation of a group G is a group homomorphism rho from G to GLV, where this is the automorphism group. And as we know, it is isomorphic to the set of all invertible matrices of order D. So I think now the title would be clear. That is, given any G, we are actually getting a matrix. And what we are doing is we are going to study something regarding this matrices, the determinant of this matrices. And the parameter D here is called as the dimension of the representation. We also need to understand the concept of irreducibles. For that, suppose W is a subspace of V, W is said to be G invariant if every G in G maps every element of W to some other element of W. And a representation is said to be irreducible if it has no non-trivial invariant subspaces. That is, the only invariant subspaces are the zero subspace and the whole space. And the concept of irreducibles is important because of this result, which states that every representation of a finite group G over a field F with characteristic not dividing the order of G can be written as the direct sum of irreducible representations. So here the representations we are interested in are over the complex fields. And so to study about the representation, it is enough to know about the irreducibles of the representations. So these are some combinatorial notations I'll be using. We are all familiar with the binary notation of a number. So just like that, given any integer n and a prime r, we can always write n in its RRA form as this, as in equation one. So here the alpha i's are vary from 0 to r minus 1. And if r equal to 2, this is the binary form. Now, if r equal to 2, that is, bin of n denote the set of all powers of 2 in the binary expansion of n. That is, if r equal to 2, bin of n denote the set k1, k2, etc., kl. And order of n denote the highest power of 2 dividing n. That means if r equal to 2, the alpha i's could be 0 or 1. And if alpha not equal to 0, we have order of n will be equal to k1. And if alpha not equal to 1, the order of n will be equal to 0. And this is something called as a multinomial coefficient. As we all know about the binomial coefficient, this is a generalization of that. The binomial coefficient n choose a comma b is defined to be as n factorial by a factorial b factorial. Here we have n choose a1, a2, etc., ar, where a1 plus a2 plus ar is equal to n. And it is defined to be as n factorial divided by a1 factorial, a2 factorial, etc., ar factorial. And also we can write this as the product of this binomial coefficients. And we have a few representation theory notions. So suppose we all know that the irreducible representations of a symmetric group are parametrized by the partitions of n. So I'll be using the notation rho lambda to denote the irreducible representation of a symmetric group, where lambda is the partition of n. And f lambda denotes the dimension of the representation. G lambda denote the multiplicity of the eigenvalue minus 1 of rho lambda of 1, 2. 1, 2 is the transposition 1, 2 of the symmetric group. And this is the formula to calculate G lambda. And these are the characters of the generalized symmetric group. So suppose theta to the power I denote the character whose restriction to each factor of the cyclic group sends identity to theta to the power I, where theta is the primitive rth root of unity. and psi naught is the composition of this projection from the generalized symmetric group to the symmetric group with the sign character. With the sign character, I mean the map which sends even permutations to 1 and the odd permutations to -1. Before beginning, let me give the motivation for this work. So in the paper, the representation of a symmetric group with non-trivial determinant, the authors Aravind Iyer, Amritanshu Prasad, and Stephen Spallon gave a closed formula for the number of partitions such that the corresponding representation has a non-trivial, representation of symmetric group has a non-trivial determinant. And this was further extended by Devarun Ghosh and Stephen Spallon to the irreducible finite causative groups, mainly to the hyperoctahedral groups. So in our work, we are currently extending some of their results to the generalized symmetric group. And please note here that when r equal to 1, we have the symmetric group, and when r equal to 2, we have the hyperoctahedral group. Before beginning, there is one more notation, that is MP of G. MP of G for a group G and a P prime denote the number of inequivalent irreducible representation of G with degree prime to P. So this value was when G is the symmetric group, MP of SN was given by McDonald. He has also given the formula for hyperoctahedral groups. So we were just able to follow the same lines of proof to get the value for the generalized symmetric group. So here the P of X is the partition generating function, and this square bracket suffix X alpha K denote the coefficient of this X alpha X to the power alpha K in this polynomial, where alpha K is that term coming along with P raised to K in the PRA expansion of N. And he has also shown that when P equal to 2, for the symmetric group case, he has arrived at a closed formula, and similar to that, when we try for the generalized symmetric group.
Excuse me, I just want to understand the formula here.
Okay.
So you are substituting for x. What is so px is the partition function, right?
Yeah.
So the right hand side is some function. It's a product. It's a generating function, is it?
Yeah.
And then in the kth factor, you're substituting x to the power alpha k.
Not substituting. We are looking for the coefficient of this. So this
will
be
okay. 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 So this is the generative. Okay. I see. So you're taking px raised to the power rpk. Okay. Okay. Otherwise, it would just be px raised to the power pk product.
Yeah. Here it comes down.
It's not x to the power pk. Okay. Okay. This formula for r equals 1 is in McDonald's paper, right?
Yeah. For r equal to 2, he has done in a different paper.
Okay.
Equation of alpha k.
What, sir?
Alpha k, equation 1.
So it is when we represent, when we write n here, it is not r, it is p. Okay. When we write n in terms of the PRA form.
Okay.
It's base P.
So it's the digit in the R array expansion.
P array. P
array. Yeah.
So here P and R2 primes are coming. Okay. So when R equal to 2, for the case of symmetric group, the formula, there is a closed formula, that is 2 to the power of the product of the powers of 2 in the binary expansion of n. So similarly for the generalized group also, we have obtained a very nice formula here. This could be obtained directly as a corollary from this theorem, or also we were able to get it by using some simple combinatorics. I have not included the proof, but it's there. Now let me move on to the main part. For that, first we need to understand the irreducible representations of generalized symmetric group. Just as in the case of symmetric group, the irreducible representations here are parameterized by the multi-partitions. By a multi-partition, I mean a tuple of partitions lambda 1, lambda 2, etc., lambda r, where each lambda I is a partition of some ai, and this tuple a1, a2, ar forms a composition of n. So this rho lambda, the irreducible representation, is obtained as an induced representation from the n generalized subgroup to the generalized subgroup, where this rho lambda I plus 1 to the I is the extension of the representation of symmetric group to the generalized symmetric group. And the dimension of this part is given by the product of F lambda I's times n choose A1, A2, etc. AR. So from now on, I'll be using, there is slight misuse of notation, that is, I'll be using lambda for the multi-partition, and this lambda 1, lambda 2 will be the partitions of AI. So what we want is the determinant of this representation. And since we have the irreducible representation as an induced representation, and we actually have a formula to calculate the determinant of induced representation. Suppose pi is a representation, pi is an induced representation of rho from H to G, then determinant of pi is given by the product of these two determinants. Where here, where G mod H is the parallelogram map from the abelianization of G to the abelianization of H. By abelianization, I mean G modulo its commutator subgroup or the derived subgroup. Now, this is defined by, consider the section map G mod H to G of this quotient map. Then for every X in G mod H and for every G in G, HXG is defined to be the element such that GT of X is equal to TG of X HXG. And the parallelogram map is defined to be the product of this HXG modulo the derived subgroup. So what we want here is the determinant. First, what we want to find is the formula of the determinant. And for that, we need to find these two terms. First of all, we will look into the parallelogram map. And we first try to do it for the symmetric group case and then extend it to the generalized symmetric group. So suppose we have a composition of N, A1 plus A2 plus AR equal to N, then the parallelogram map is defined by the abelianization of symmetric group. That is, here the derived subgroup or the commutator is the alternating group. Therefore, the map is defined from SN mod AN to this subgroup. And here we will have a generator, any transposition of SN. Let it be, I am denoting it by tau n. So the parallelogram map of tau n is given by this. I will explain the proof. So suppose jn be the set 1, 2, etc. n, then P of jn is defined to be the multi-set of subsets of jn in such a way that each set is of size a1, a2, ar, and all of them unions are to give us n. So, and we are fixing an element j in P of jn as the first a1 elements, next a2 elements, and like that, and finally the last ar elements. Now consider the map from the symmetric group to P of jn defined by permuting the sets, permuting the elements in the sets. Then we know that we could see that the kernel would be the n subgroup sa1 cross etc xar. So we will have an isomorphism between sn modulo the n subgroup with P of jn. Now pick any section T from P of Jn to Sn as T of Xj is equal to X. So just for clarity, I'm taking tau n to be the transposition, the 1, 2. Then we can, from the definition of the parallelogram, we have this HXS1 was defined to be this form. And we can also see that this product, that is HXS1, HS1XS1 is equal to 1. Now, since the parallelogram map was defined to be the product of all HXS1, and since these terms are coming to be 1, we can actually omit the terms, and the product will be restricted to the set of all X in P of Jn such that X1X is equal to X. And this means both 1 and 2 lie in the same set, in the multi-set. And in this case, HXS1 will be equal to tau of AI for some transposition tau of AI in SAI. So, and the number of elements, the number of multisets in P of JN containing 1 and 2 in its ith set will be equal to N minus 2 choose A1, etc., AI minus 2, etc., AR. Therefore, the map, the function, the product will be this. Now, going for the generalized symmetric group. So the map will be from the abelianization of generalized symmetric group to the abelianization of this N subgroup. So here the it will be generated by an element from the symmetric group and an element from the cyclic group. So and since we have this SN modulo its nth subgroup will be isomorphic to the generalized symmetric group modulo its nth subgroup. So we can actually extend the map from the symmetric group, the parallelogram map from the symmetric group to the generalized symmetric group. And now we only need to look for the case of the element in the cyclic group. We follow the same notations as in the previous proof. Then we have tau T of X inverse acting on X is equal to J, and T of X inverse of 1 belongs to the kth set in the multiset JK if and only if 1 belongs to the kth set in the multiset X. Then HXE1 will be as defined in the definition of the parallelogram map. And here this will come to be EK, where K is the tau X inverse of 1. So therefore HXE1 is equal to EK. And the number of elements, and this will be equal to the number of elements containing one in its kth set, that is equal to n minus 1 choose a1, etc., ak minus 1, etc., ar. Therefore, we have this formula. So now we have the parallelogram map for the generalized symmetric group, and it has two generators, tau n and en. So what we need is this exterior product with the parallelogram of SN. And this formula comes by the formula for the determinant of the tensor product of matrices. So it's just the substituting the formula. And now this F lambda K hat denotes the product of all F lambda 1, F lambda 2, etc., F lambda R with its kth term omitted from the product. Similarly for the case of En. If you could remember, there was one more term that we need, that is a determinant of CG mod H to the power dimension of rho. So to find the determinant of the permutation module, what we need is the action of the permutation module will be factored through the action of SN, as because EN acts trivially, the element of the cyclic group acts trivially, and the element of the S1 acts of the symmetric group acts by permuting the multisets. The number of orbits in this set will be equal to the number of sets in the multiset which contain 1 and 2 in two different sets. And the number of such sets will be equal to this term. Therefore, we have determinant of the permutation module is equal to psi naught to the power of this. So now we have all the terms. What we need is we just need to multiply everything, and we have this formula for the determinant. So till now, I know the proof won't be much clear, but if you could not follow the proof also, I hope that you can follow the coming slides, because what we need to understand from here is that the determinant is coming to be the power of theta power of something with a sign on that. So there will be two R possibilities for the determinant, plus or minus theta powers, where the power of theta is an element of the cyclic groups. Theta is the rth root of unity. Therefore, the power of theta will be an element of the cyclic group of order R. And I'm denoting the power of theta in my notation will be X lambda, and I'll be denoting the power of psi naught to be Y lambda. So if Y lambda is even, we have the determinant is positive. And if Y lambda is odd, the determinant will be negative. I hope this is clear.
So remind me, G lambda K is
which one, sir?
G subscript lambda.
G lambda K is the multiplicity of this eigenvalue minus 1 in rho lambda 1, 2.
Okay. And F lambda K hat is the product of the dimensions with the kth factor
omitted. So the determinant, we have two R possibilities, and that will be plus or minus theta powers. Okay. So now I'll be characterizing this determinant based on this X lambda and Y lambda. Okay. So if you could see here in the formula of X lambda, we have the product of F lambdas, and there is a summation of multinomial coefficients. So the characterization is based on simply on this compositions A1, A2, etc., AR. What the theorem says is, given any compositions A1, A2, AR of n with R and O prime, such that all the multinomial coefficients lie in the same residue class modulo R, then X lambda is congruent to 0 modulo R. So x lambda congruent to 0 modulo r means the determinant is either plus or minus 1. Okay, x lambda is a multiple of r. That means the determinant will be either plus or minus 1. And the proof is quite simple. That is, when we just take the, so in x lambda, there was the product of f lambda with this summation. So when we take the summation, we have, since all of them lie in the same residue class modulo r, it will be simply the summation k equal to 1 to r minus 1 of k. And since r is an odd prime, r minus 1 will be even. And therefore, it will be left with a multiple of r. And therefore, x lambda will be congruent to 0 modulo r.
How do you construct such compositions? Is it easy to enumerate?
So this is the formula of x lambda.
Yeah.
So I'm not constructing the composition. I'm saying that given any A1, A2, etc., AR, suppose all these compositions are...
I know, I understand. But I'm just wondering, like, yeah, you know, how common are such compositions? Is there an easy way to find them?
Maybe in the two slides after, I'm giving a few examples.
Okay.
So so this is the characterization of X lambda based on the... that is, actually this theorem gives us whether the determinant will be, according to this theorem, if this condition satisfies, the possibilities of determinant are only plus or minus 1. Now, if y lambda is even, if the corresponding composition satisfies any of the following condition, yeah, the first term looks, the first condition looks a bit high, but what it actually says is, suppose if you have two elements, ai and aj, and what we are doing is we write both ai and aj in its binary form and avoiding the first one that occurs in both ai and aj. Suppose if both ai and aj has a one coming in the same position, avoiding the first one coming in both, then y lambda will be even. And the other cases, I think it's easy to understand. That is, if three of the AKs are congruent to 2 modulo 4, that is, when we write in the binary form, it ends with 1, 0, then there exists three of them which are congruent to either 3 or 2. No, it's like there exists three AKs which are congruent to 1 congruent to 3, and the other congruent to 2, and the other congruent to 1 modulo 4. And if there exists at least four of them which are odd. So according to this characterization, what we can have is that the y lambda is even means all the determinant will be always positive. So this is the table I have mentioned earlier. So based on this, I have got a few examples to characterize that the determinant. So this is based on both the condition on x lambda and y lambda. That is, x lambda is congruent to 0 modulo r and the y lambda is even. And the second is based on the condition on x lambda. And the last five are based on the condition on y lambda. That is, y lambda is even means the only possible determinants are the positive powers of theta. So since we had the formula of the determinant, we were able to calculate these values. That is, the number of by n theta of n, I denote the number of multipartitions of n with determinant theta. We were able to calculate this table. We got this table using the SAGE math. So what is interesting observation was that when r is a prime, we have all the theta powers. That is, when theta power is not a multiple of r, are equal. N theta and theta square are equal. When r equal to 5, n theta, n theta square, n theta cube, n theta to the power 4 are equal. Similarly for the negative case. And one more interesting thing is that if you could see when r equal to 3 and n is less than r, that is, if r equal to 3, see the first two rows, all the positive terms are coming to be equal, and similarly all the negatives are coming to be equal. And also in the case of 5, that is, generally for if r equal to r is a prime, then for n less than r, that is, if you could see here the first four rows, all the positives are coming to be equal, and similarly all the negatives are coming to be equal. And in all other cases, we have only condition for theta to the power s, where s is less than r. So we will be proving these inequalities in the next few slides. For that, First, let us see how the when we permute the indices of the partition, what will be the effect on the value of x lambda and y lambda. Suppose when we permute the indices of the partition, that is just applying a permutation of SR on this multi-partition, the value, yeah, the expression is quite big, but the take home is that the x lambda, the value of x lambda changes by a factor, but the y lambda remains constant. So the y lambda remains constant means the sign remains constant. So when you change the, when you permute the indices of a multi-partition, the sign doesn't changes, only the value of x lambda changes. And one more thing to be noted here is that when we are actually permuting the indices of a multi-partition, what we are doing is we are changing the composition. We are changing the underlying composition A1, A2, etc., AR. So when we change the underlying composition, the value of x lambda changes, but the good thing is that the y lambda, the sign doesn't changes. And here is the lemma. So from now on, we will be assuming our R to be a prime number. And this lemma actually states that suppose we have a given any A1, A2, etc., AR, any composition of N with all the multinomial coefficients not from the same residue class modulo R, then there exists, we can actually find a composition A out of this set A1, A2, etc., AR, such that this summation is not a multiple of R. So this is a simple algorithm. I haven't included the proof here. Based on this, we can say we have another proposition which states that given any composition of N with all the multinomial coefficients not from the same residue class modulo R, then given any S which is less than R, which is from 1 to R minus 1, we can find a permutation pi such that on applying the permutation to this summation term in the x lambda, we can get it is equal to congruent to S modulo R. So the proof is quite simple again. So just without loss of generality, because of the above lemma, we can assume that the summation is equal to 1 modulo R. Now just expand it, multiply throughout by an S. And if you could see here, when it was in the K plus 1th position was multiplied by a K. So if this is multiplied by an S means it has to come in the S plus 1th position. Similarly, multiplied by 2S means it has to come in the 2S plus 1th position and so on. So this will be the permutation. So what it says is that given any x lambda, suppose we know the x lambda, it is not congruent to 0 modulo R. If x lambda is not congruent to 0 modulo R, the summation which appears in the x lambda will also be not congruent to 0 modulo R. They also, the other term coming in the formula of x lambda was the product of f lambdas. So definitely it also not congruent to 0 modulo R. So what we have here is that we can actually find a permutation such that we can go to each conjugate C-class modulo R. Okay, so that we can actually find a permutation on the composition or on the indices of the multi-partition such that the multi-partition, the determinant of the multi-partition visits each conjugate C-class modulo R or theta to the power S of R. And therefore, we have this theorem that is n theta to the power s of n are all equal. This was the first observation from the table. That is, all the n theta power s are equal where s is less than r. Now, if n is less than r, what we have is all n theta power s are equal for 1 less than or equal to s less than or equal to r. As we have seen in the previous theorem, we have this condition for n less than r. So now what we need to show is that suppose this summation is equal to 1 modulo R, we have to find a permutation such that this summation is equal to 0 modulo R. For that, since N is less than R, here actually the condition N is less than R is helpful, but more helpful condition is that since N is not a multiple of R and each of the AK is not a multiple of R, we can find a T in the set 1 to R minus 1 such that T times this summation is equal to minus 1 modulo R. Now just add the two and we will get that this is congruent to 0 modulo R. So the LHS is actually obtained by the cyclic permutation, by applying a cyclic permutation to the power of T. What we have here is that when n is not a multiple of R, we can actually find a permutation so that we can move on from the determinant between 1 to theta to the power s for any s. and therefore we also have this proposition which states that n theta to the power s of n is less than or equal to n1 of n. Here we know that if n is not a multiple of, if n is less than r, this is actually equal, and the less than or equal to comes because of the factor of this product of f lambdas coming in the formula of x lambda. So again, so just to keep it in a nutshell, these are the inequalities that I have proved in the last few slides. So we have n theta to the power s are all equal for 1 less than or equal to s less than r. And if n is less than r, all are equal, that is including n theta to the power s for 1 less than or equal to s less than or equal to r. Now, if n is not a multiple of r, we have n theta to the power s of n is less than or equal to n1 of n, and similarly for the negative case. Now this is the last part of this. So what we need is we are trying to find this count, that is given any composition A of n and theta is a primitive rth root of unity, n theta s to the power of a denote the set of all multipartitions obtained from all the composition. It's not just the composition a1, a2, etc., ar, but all the composition that can be obtained from this set a1, a2, etc., ar, whose determinant is theta to the power s. First, we begin with calculating the total number of positive determinants. For that, we denote a naught of a to be the number of. For that, we first denote a naught of a to be the number of irreducible representations. Sorry, the number of multi-partitions such that each lambda I is a partition of AI and Y lambda is even. That is, we are calculating the positive determinant, number of multi-partitions with a positive determinant whose underlying composition is A1, A2, etc., AR. And since we have seen that when we change the composition, when we permute the composition, the value of Y lambda doesn't changes. That is, the sign remains constant. So what we have is, it's enough to get the value for any composition A of n. For concreteness, I'm taking A to be the partition of n. So this, so suppose if we know A1 of A and A0 of A, we have the summation S equal to 1 to R n minus theta S of A, that is, for any composition from the set A1, A2, etc., AR, the total number of multi-partitions giving positive determinant will be equal to the number of ways of permuting A1, A2, etc., AR times A1 of A. Similarly, I'm denoting this to be A0 of A. And what we have here is A0 of A plus A1 of A is equal to the product of partitions of A1, A2, etc., AR. So if we know any one of A1 or A0, we can actually get the other just by subtracting from this product. For that, I'm using a lemma from the earlier papers, that is, Bn denote the number of chiral partitions of Sn. Then this gives the number of partitions of N such that F lambda and G lambda are odd. F lambda is odd and G lambda is even. Now F lambda is odd and G lambda is, sorry, F lambda is even and G lambda is odd. So this is the count. I'll be using this count for the proof. So this is the theorem which gives us the value. This is the proposition which gives us the value of A1 of A. So it is classified into two cases. That is, the multinomial, all the multinomial coefficients are even and a few of them are odd. If all of them are even, again, it breaks up into two cases. Now, if m of them are odd, where I denote this indexing set of this a1, a2, etc., ar with odd to be the set I. So let's recall the formula of Y lambda. So the condition was, the first case was that all the multinomial coefficients in the second term are even. Suppose all of these are even, what we have is the second summand is already even, and so to be for the Y lambda to be odd, we need either this to be odd or all the F lambda to be odd. So suppose if this term, this summation is actually even, A1 will be equal to zero, And if all the f lambda, if at least one of the f lambda is even also, the whole term will be even. So the only possibility is that all the f lambdas are odd, and the g lambdas can take all the 2r raised to r possibilities. It doesn't depend on the parity of g lambda. So therefore, the formula will be this by using the above lemma. Now the next case is that only we are choosing only m of them are odd. Then if m of them are odd, what we have is, so if m of them are odd, if two of the f lambdas are even, already this term will be even, and similarly this will be even. So the only possibility is that at least one of the f lambda is even, or all the f lambdas are odd. And if this one f lambda k doesn't belongs to that indexing set I, then both the terms in the summation are even, and hence the case is not possible. So for that particular I's with f lambda I, we need the corresponding g lambda I to be odd. And therefore the number of such partitions will be this. So we are just summing over all the possibilities, the number of partitions with exactly one of the lambda I in that indexing set I, having f lambda I even and g lambda I odd will be equal to this. Now the subcase two is all the f lambda k's are odd. So if then for k doesn't belongs to I, we have g lambda k could be even or odd. So it has 2r-m choices. For the rest of the m g lambdas, it is the parity of g lambda is fixed as odd or even depending on the parity of this term. Therefore, we have 2m-1 choices. Then the number of possible partitions are just by using the above lemma, we have this. So now we are just summing the two cases, subcase one and subcase two, and we have this formula. So finally, by the characterization of the x lambda, we can get the count for the number of multi partitions using the characterization of x lambda. We have seen that if all the all these multinomial coefficients lie in the same residue class modulo R, then the determinant is either 1 or -1. And now we have the total count of positives and negatives. And since the n zeta powers are coming to be, where power is not a multiple of r, are coming to be 0, we have the count of n1 and n-1 of a. And I just put the values from the table, so we can actually calculate the n zetas for this two compositions. And because of this, now on we will be assuming that all the multinomial coefficients does not lie in the same residue class modulo R. And we have also seen that if n is not a multiple of R, we have seen, and each ak is less than R, all the n zeta powers are equal, positive powers are equal, and similarly the positive negative determinants are equal. Therefore, and now we know the total number of positives. So what we need is we just need to multiply throughout by R, and we have this formula for the n zeta to the power s of a and n minus zeta to the power s of a. And this actually gives us the formula for, if a is a composition of n where n is less than R, then it satisfies these two conditions, that is n is not a multiple of R and each ak will be less than R. And therefore we have the formula for this, n zeta to the power s of n. And also we know that to get this value n zeta to the power s of n, what we need is we need to sum it over all the partitions of n. And this is, we are just calculating the zeta to the power 1 and -1, total number of partitions with determinant 1 and -1, and total number of multi partitions with determinant zeta to the power s and minus zeta to the power s. So this actually helps us if we know any one of this, like we know that all the n zeta power s are equal. So if we know either the whether if the determinant is always positive or if the determinant is always negative, this helps us to calculate the values of all the n zetas. So these are the few compositions which we have in the table, the last five which had by the characterization of y lambda. So this theorem actually helps us to calculate the n zetas for these compositions. So the proof follows by, if all the multinomial coefficient, as we have assumed, it doesn't lie in the same residue class modulo R, then this summation visits each congruency class congruent to, not congruent to zero modulo R. And similarly, if n is not a multiple of R, it visits all congruency class congruent to zero modulo R. In this case, the number of compositions will be equal to the total number of composition that we can be obtained from A1, A2, etc. AR divided by R minus 1 if N is a multiple of R. And if N is not a multiple of R, divide the number of permutations of this A1, A2, AR by R. And to get, here we are looking for x lambda not equal to 0 modulo R. So for that we need each f lambda is not a multiple of R. So each f lambda is not a multiple of R means the total number of such multipartitions will be equal to the product MR of SAK. That is the number of partitions whose dimension is relatively prime to R. Now if N is a multiple of R, this x lambda is multiple of R if and only if any of the f lambda is congruent to 0 modulo R. In this case, and we can choose so if any of the f lambda is k is a multiple of R, the determinant, the x lambda will be a multiple of R for all the compositions, and therefore we have all the compositions here times all the, so this will be the number of multipartitions of lambda 1, lambda 2, etc., lambda k, such that each f lambda, at least one of the f lambda k is a multiple of R. And if n is not a multiple of R, we have seen that this will be obviously included because we have seen that n theta s and n 1 are equal. Like we can actually find a permutation between the composition, but we also have to include these terms to incorporate the role of this f lambda case. So this is the thing. And the final thing, so what we are lacking here is that we know the total number of multipartitions is given by this count of each. And we know that we have got the count of N1 plus N theta, that is the total number of positives, and also the count of total number of negatives, that is N minus 1 and N minus theta. And also in the last slide, we have seen the count of N1 plus N minus 1 and N theta plus N minus theta. Okay, so if we know any one of these four values, we can actually get all the other. Okay, but we were not able to get any of this. And the reason I think is because we didn't have this count, the number of irreducible representations of a symmetric group whose dimension is relatively prime to both 2 and an odd prime R. I hope if we get this count, we can just follow the lemmas from the earlier papers and just proceed. So these are my references. So this was the first paper on the symmetric group, and this is the paper on the hyperheptahedral group. And this is the paper of McDonald in which he has proved for the symmetric group. And in this, he has proved for the hyperheptahedral groups. Thank you.
Thank you, Amrita. Let's unmute our mics and give a big hand to Amrita. So are there any questions?
I have a question, I guess.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, Amrita. So I wanted to go back to this theorem where you have the n zeta s's are all equal, independent of s. I think it's around page 25 or so. So this is when n is prime, I think. No, not
I
that
is
one.
Prime.
Yeah. So not okay. That. Yeah, right. That's good. No. Okay. Yeah. So let's. Yeah. So this thing here, say. So I think I might have I wanted to make a suggestion. I think another way to prove this would be the fact that I think there's an automorphism of your group G and R, where I take, so I think the units of Z mod RZ, I think they act as automorphisms on this generalized symmetric group. Just by multiplying by the vector part. And so let's say my unit is u.
Okay.
So this automorphism, maybe theta sub u, mm-hmm. it induces bijections on these linear characters, these determinants, and also on the irreducible representations in a way that is compatible with the determinant. And so I think it takes, this automorphism is going to take zeta to the s to zeta to the us,
uh-huh.
If I have this all right.
Uh-huh.
And so it's going to take representations with determinant zeta s to representations with determinant us.
Okay, I will try.
Now, the reason I'm mentioning this is because I think this will extend, you'll be able to say something like this in the case where R is not prime.
Okay. Yeah, for R is not prime, by Sage, I have observed some, like there is also some pattern, but it doesn't appear that like all are not equal, but few of them are coming to be equal.
Yeah, so you get orbits of these, right? So I would guess that the orbits correspond to the ideals of Z mod RZ.
Okay.
So like if you did Z mod 4Z, then maybe S equal 1 and S equal 3 should be the same. Right. So I wonder if you might be able to use that to extend some of your results to the non-prime case.
Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen. So that may also, would it shed any light on the ratios of the frequencies for different powers of theta? Have you looked at that when R is not a prime, that you compare the number of things with different powers of zeta?
There is some ratio, like some columns are coming to be equal, some zeta powers are coming to be equal. But like I don't remember. Like,
but the unequal numbers, do they have some nice? So like as Stephen said, if you take zeta, some power of zeta and multiply it by another power of zeta that's co-prime to R, then you will get the same count. But if you now as he said, the Z mod RZ is a ring, but you can break it up into subsets. So the most, the units, but then there are also things which are in, inside ideals. So you sort of stratify it by the order of the cyclic group generated by these elements. And each of those classes should have different count. And maybe there's also some relation between those counts. Do you have the table where you have these for some value of R that is not prime?
No, of course. Now I don't have. Maybe I will share.
Sure, that would be interesting to look at. Any other questions? Okay. No more questions, then let's thank Amrita once again.